don't know if they're formal service, if we really, I'd like to sing some songs and let the Lord help us in that. I'd just like for us to mix our voices together and everybody just relax. I don't feel like we're under any pressure. But I think it's good to share.
Yes, amen.
We've got just a few minutes left of this year. And I fully believe we had a good year.
Yes, amen.
Very profitable year. I think our church has grown this year. You know, it's not the numbers. But we have added some, and that's been a blessing for us. And I appreciate the ones that have been added to the course of these last few months that the Lord has brought us Brother Rico this year.
Yes, amen.
And he certainly is part of us. He's part of our assembly, and I'm very proud of him. I'm very proud that he's here. And I told him the other day we're going to go shopping together and get him some ties that he doesn't have to tie. Some ties he could just slip on. And I need a suit or two.
Yes, amen.
Since I've lost this weight, my clothes is kind of baggy on me, Rico's been a real addition to our assembly.
Yes, amen.
I'm very proud that God brought him here, and he's happy to be part of this church, and I'll let him tell his story as he would feel at this point. Then Sister Wanda has been added to us this year.
Yes, amen.
And of course, Gus, too.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And Brother Howard is Gus's grandpa, but I'm his Pompey.
Yes. Yeah.
And I guess I'm a lot of those kids' Pompey, but that's okay. I like it. George is here tonight. She just couldn't hardly wait to come to church in her pajamas. She's staying with us for a week or so, and we're happy she's with us.
Yes.
There's been a few more, and I'm getting old. I can't remember stuff. We're glad that. And then not only that, though, let's leave the numbers as they are, but thank the Lord for them. And I'm not trying to eliminate that, but I feel like the church has grown so much spiritually.
Amen.
That we've got people that used to be backwards, and now you'd have to really pry them up off their seat.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord has helped them to get a zeal and to get an enthusiasm. And of course, that's wonderful to have a zeal and enthusiasm, but I think that what I appreciate is the embedded love of God that is put into our hearts.
Yes.
And our eyes are starting to understand more. You know, I used to think it was all, you were saved, you went to the ritual of, and I don't mean to belittle it, I just mean that the action of a water baptism. Then we would receive the Holy Ghost. And the emphasis, because we were of the old Pentecostal root, there was so much emphasis on speaking in other tongues. And I still think that is, yes it is. I believe it is a sign of the Holy Ghost being in a person. I think that's still there, but I'm just saying that it's not just going for an experience. But the Holy Ghost is so much more than what I ever thought.
Yes, it is.
And what we were taught. And because our relationship was more or less built into a ministry. And I still believe in the ministry. Don't misunderstand me. And I think you know that. But the emphasis is not... the ministry is an instrument in God's hands to help us to make it. And it is the order that God's put into the church. But the understanding that we have now is that we can actually build a relationship with Christ. Mm-hmm. Now, we're still working on that. Well, I'm glad we're as far as we are, because our eyes are starting to open.
Amen.
And our experiences are growing greater. And our foundation is becoming greater. And our, you know, we're trenching in the to an attitude, and or rather to a spirit, that we are, yes, we are. We are God's children.
Yes, we are.
We were born again. Not of a natural flesh. And I think John, the elder John that wrote the book of John in the three epistles, which are credited to him, but there's always been hesitation because they were written after the fact. But that's neither here or there. It is something that is recognizable to John, John, who also was the author of Revelations. But John is so adamant about, in his writings and his setting, if you take the first and second and third chapter, book of 1 John, 2nd and 3rd, and you start to read it, and you start to understand, and that's one thing that I'm learning more so about the Bible. I studied the Bible several years, but the thing I'm understanding more so, if I understand what spawned those certain letters, or what caused the statements to be made, why were these statements made? You know, that's important, because when you start to understand why certain statements were made, then you start to understand exactly what's being said, and you start reasoning why these things were said. Now, it's important to understand doctrinally, it's important to understand theologically those things, but it's also important to recognize if, say for example, there was a reason why Jesus would come, or even his actions, some of his actions were in relationship to trying to show somebody something, and then to understand why that person, or what spawned that, why that person was saying that, and then to be able to see why Jesus offset that with a parable, possibly. He used a lot of parables. He didn't just use parables, though. He also used physical actions to demonstrate a thought, or to demonstrate a doctrinal area. He used several incidences that would come. Just like he took the one blind man. There was a blind man. He touched his eyes, and he said, "Can you see?" Remember that?
Man.
He said, "Yeah, I can see people like trees. They're just like trees." So his eyesight wasn't totally clear at that point. And so Jesus prayed for him again. Well, there was a reason he did that. There was a purpose in him doing that. He was showing that you can have a partial eyesight and not see the total picture. Some of us have been in this thing all our lives. You know, this is all I know. I've been in this thing all my life. That's a long time, isn't it? Because the reason my folks moved from Amsterdam to the United States, we didn't move here because this is a great country to be a part of. I mean, it is, but I'm just saying that's not what our motive was. We were going to a church that was our pastor and the pastor in Hilversum, Brother Holly. He had a smaller church. He had about 30, 40 people. And I remember going to his assembly when I was a boy and watched my dad be water baptized there. I remember some of those instances, and they became in contact with Brother Souders, and they traveled to conventions, to meetings. My pastor Wood, who was a, I believe he was a professor. He had a master's degree, and he was in psychology, but he was teaching. I believe he was teaching school then. And he would come over to the country, and other colleague would come over. I've got pictures of them in shaking hands and being around Brother Souders. And they came over here, and then when our church was being persecuted, Brother Souders just said, "Well, let's make a long-term plan." Took them about 5 years before the congregation was totally moved over to the United States. But we didn't come because of the great country that this country is. We came because of the body of Christ. And our vision was to be a part of the body. And the Lord allowed us to, I remember my parents, the only thing they had when they came into this country was a 10 by 10 wooden crate that had some of our household goods in it, some of our furniture, my mom and dad's furniture, was in that crate. My dad didn't have a job. He started mowing yards for different people. And until he found something that he could hang on to. But our purpose was to be in the church, part of the Bradenton Assembly. The Lord helped us to stay. And all our lives have been dedicated to this group of people. But the Lord has, and I'm not saying I'm abandoning that, but I do say there's more, and there's got to be more. Last night I was kind of moved, and I was sentimental. I went back on the internet, and I saw different conventions and different songs, or rather different meetings and camp meetings they were having. And I looked at that, and they had great crowds. They had a good crowd at the camp meetings. They do now. And then the Louisville Christian Assembly Center that they have there, it was full. And a beautiful band, beautiful orchestra. And some of my emotions were caught up in that because that's part of my past. And it caused me to be reminisce some things and miss the companionship of some of the brethren. But I looked at that and I thought, Lord, I thank the Lord for Christian Assembly in Sebring, Florida.
Yeah.
Because we're not a form, and we're not a ceremonial type group. And I looked at their big band, big orchestra, and of course we used to always say we don't have a form, but yet we do have.
Yes.
And I looked at that and I said, thank you, Lord, that I'm a part of the family of God.
Amen.
That we're trying to find a true relationship with Jesus Christ. In that true relationship, God has opened our hearts to that this year, hasn't he?
Yes, amen.
Absolutely. The Lord has opened our hearts and our spirit to that. Movement that God has put into our hearts, and it's not in a movement. It's in the body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ is made up of more than just what we recognize as the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. But, and then, what is the body of Christ? And I don't want to take a lot all the time, but I look at the statements in the scriptures that really, what did those apostles really push? And what was their ultimate? They did believe in order. We've got a good sign of that. But were they so rigid that, you know, that you had to wear a suit and tie, or you had to do this, or, and I think it looks proper for anyone to be in any kind of leadership role or any type of role that sits on a platform or sits in a place that the attire should be. But what I'm trying to say is it's not a form. It's not a fashion. It's none of that. That's not what it is. But it is a true birth that happens, because we were born of the flesh, and that's flesh. You can put it any way you want to, it's flesh. That necessitated another birth of the Spirit. And that is what they kept and they kept on trying to keep this in focus in the church. And I see something in that. I wish I could break it down for you. Give me another few months and I will, because I really believe this is where we're on the right track.
Yes.
And when we can really understand that we have to be born again. To make it, we have to be born again.
Yes, we do.
We can say what we want to, we can try to soft soap it. We can try to make people feel good, and I'm not trying to hurt anyone's, I'm not going to hurt someone intentionally, but it takes a rebirth. You cannot be saved with a natural, fleshly experience. You can't do it. Because that which is born of the flesh is flesh. You can't change that. That's why he kept reiterating that. You've got to be born of the Spirit. And so this year's been an exciting year for us.
Yes, it has.
We've had some things happen, you know. I mean, Sister Marcia had to just break that ankle. I mean, she just had to. She just had to see how much she could put on me.
Yes, amen.
That's what she did, you know. And I kept reading that scripture that, you know, in Corinthians, that he would not put anything more on you that you could not bear.
Yes.
And I said, Lord, I'm almost there.
And God laughed.
But then we've had some bad news on Devin and Brendan. Brendan is really failing. He's starting to fail.
Yes.
But yet, the good news outweighs the bad.
Yes, it does.
And we have a good foundational assembly. Some of us have been tried so much this year, and yet there's still a joy in our heart.
Yes, amen.
A lot of us have gone through trial after trial, haven't we?
Yes, amen.
Going through one condition after another.
Yes.
And yet, I'm still saying praise God.
Yes.
Thank God for 2013.
Yes.
God has helped us. And we've done some things. But you know, when you start to think on the spiritual man, and you start to become a spiritual person, some of the things in the fleshly realm don't weigh as much as they used to.
Mm-hmm.
Have you found that to be so?
Yes.
They just don't weigh as much as they used to. Because it's, when you start to really go ahead and get that birth take place. Now you can just be born and be a baby all the rest of your, that still doesn't promise you eternal life.
Nope.
Eternal life only comes when you have moved into a position mm-hmm. where you're a spiritual man
Amen.
Or woman. You are totally spiritual. That's eternal life. That is eternal life.
Yes.
That's what eternal life is.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus came to demonstrate that while he was walking here on this earth. He walked in a natural person.
Yes.
And he walked here on this earth and he was a natural person. Mm-hmm. And he went through some of the things that we go through.
Oh, yeah.
And he actually proved that it could be done.
Mm-hmm.
It could be done.
Yes, amen.
It could be done.
Absolutely.
And he proved to us mm-hmm. that it could be done. Somebody said, but he was the Son of God. Doesn't make any difference. He could have failed. He had the potential to fail.
Yes, he did.
He had the same struggle that you have.
Amen.
Same struggle that I have. Can you imagine? Here's the Son of God, and he had 12 dummies around him at one point. Really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you shouldn't talk about the apostle. Well, I'm just being factual. I mean, they just read the Gospels. You'll see
mm-hmm.
that they got mixed up and got confused and they were hearing him say things and they didn't understand what he was saying
mm-hmm.
repetitively over and over again. Even when Jesus came to wash Peter's feet, you remember that? He put a towel around him. Jesus wrapped a towel around him. And he got a bowl and he said, I'm going to wash your feet. Now you have to understand, customarily, that was a custom back then.
Yeah.
Because they walked in those sandals.
Mm-hmm.
And in that part of the country, your feet got filthy dirty
mm-hmm.
when you walked the streets and you walked from one place to another.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a custom to wash your feet when you got to a certain place.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jesus was demonstrating something to them.
Mm-hmm.
And he had that towel wrapped around him. You know, now, there's a whole doctrine about washing feet, you know.
Yes.
I mean, the Pentecostals, some, they probably have a foot washing tonight, some of them do. But anyway, Jesus went and he was trying to show those guys something. And he got to Peter and Peter said, oh, you're not washing my feet. Can you imagine telling Jesus that? I mean, I couldn't imagine telling Jesus. Peter said, "You're not washing my feet." Nope. But he was a bodacious person, really. Peter was.
Yeah.
You know, he said at one time, if you remember, just before the crucifixion, Peter said, "I'm not going to desert you." Mm-hmm. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Jesus said, "Hey, buddy, when the cock crows twice," three times, wasn't it? Yeah, cock crows three times, you have already. You've already, you know, denied me.
Denied three times, yeah.
You've already denied me three times. That's really what it was. Not the cock crowing three times, but the cock crowed twice. Well, anyway, to make that story short, what the meaning of it was is that the Lord said, "Peter, you will deny me. You will." But he was so boldacious. In fact, when a woman walked up to him, he said, "Look, hey, aren't you one of those guys?" "Not me! No, sir! Not me! I'm not." Okay. What happened to his loyalty? Where did it go? Well, here Jesus, this other incident we started on, he had a towel wrapped around him, around his waist, and he would go to these, each individual, he'd wash their feet. And it was a job washing feet back then. My goodness, I can just imagine. And he'd wash their feet and take the towel and dry their feet, and you go next to Peter and said, "Not me, you're not washing my feet." Mm-hmm. And then Jesus said, "Well, if I don't wash your feet, you're not going to get there, buddy. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get there." "Oh, well, in that case, don't just wash my feet, but wash me everywhere." Peter didn't see what Jesus was trying to do.
Amen.
What Jesus was trying to do. Then Jesus followed up with that. Now, you have to read this setting, and then you come to this setting, the next setting. Jesus kept... He said, "Now, you cannot do it like, you can't get into this thing because of prestige, or because you're part of this, or you're part of that." He said, "But you'll have to become, as I am, a servant."
Yes. Amen.
A servant to one another.
Mm-hmm.
Love one another. The emphasis in the scriptures is love.
Yes.
We're to love God with all our soul and all our strength. That's the first thing we need to do. Mm-hmm. But then we're to love our neighbor.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to be careful and be wise, because sometimes you can feed the carnal flesh of an individual by looking after them. And they'll take advantage of that area. And you, what are you doing then? You're feeding flesh. And you're helping flesh. So there's wisdom in all things. But Jesus is trying to help us. And he's opening the door for us. And then I look at Sister Alice back there. She was way out in nowhere's land. And then William bought a home not too far from Sister Wilma.
Yes.
And she's closer in.
Yes, amen.
And I'm glad she is.
Amen. Oh,
me too.
Because God, she said, "Me too." But that was an exciting move for her.
Yes.
And it was an exciting move for us.
Yes.
Because it puts a greater continuity between us.
Yes, amen.
To help us. And the Lord is opening the doors to those that, or eyes to those that are seeing. And sometimes people don't see, and I'm sorry. But you know, you can't see if you don't put your heart into it.
That's right.
And you have to put your heart into it.
Amen.
And And that, when your heart's in it, then it builds a continuity with those that are, you know, after the same goal, the same purpose. You know, it's hard to be a part of something if your goal isn't there, if your vision isn't there.
It's true.
If you haven't got your mind set and your vision set. And then you feel like, well, everybody's rejecting me. Everybody's not really wanting to be around me. Well, it's because we have to all become a part.
Amen.
And there has to be a unit.
Yes.
A unity of the Spirit.
Amen.
And I feel that in our midst.
Amen.
More than I ever have.
Absolutely.
All through the years. There's a unity in this assembly.
Amen.
Can you lift your hand and just say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord for that move. And that evidence that's there. Growth that's there. All right. I appreciate the new year coming in 19, oops, too far back. 2014 is going to be an exciting year for our assembly. I really anticipate a deeper growth in our assembly.
Yes, amen.
Let's pray for those that are sick and those that can't be in the services like they want to be. But I'm praying, Lord, I don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to put matching chairs in this building for the first time.
Praise God.
For the first time, somebody said it doesn't make any difference. Yes,
it does.
I think we ought to make it the best.
Amen.
Yes.
Because remember, people, when a person walks in this church, what are they born of?
Flesh.
Flesh.
Yeah.
And what is their first sight that they see?
Mm-hmm.
The carnal things.
Mm-hmm.
They see how we act.
Yes.
You know, I mean, well, we're a poor church, but yes, we are a poor church, but we still need to do the best we can.
Yes, we do.
And provide, because we can get lax. I used to get so lax on that. Well, God will bring them in.
Mm-hmm.
After 20-some years, where are they at? No, really, where are they at?
True.
But God can help us.
Amen.
And help us to do better. And we're going to look into buying some chairs, and I'm going to step out by faith that God will provide. And how many believe God can provide?
Yes,
He will and can.
Yes, He will.
Because there are people that are looking this way. I was talking to one of the car dealers in town today, the guy that owns it. And I was talking to him, and he recognized me. And at first he didn't recognize me, and then he kept looking at me. He said, "Didn't you buy a Cadillac from me?" I said, "Are you kidding me? I wouldn't buy no Cadillac. What's wrong with you?" And I knew he was trying to place me. And then all of a sudden it dawned on him who I was. And then he started treating me respectful.
Yes.
And he told me, he said, "Don't you have a daughter that's married to John Tillman?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "In fact, his daughter is with us, staying with us right now." And he was talking about John, and I said, "When are you going to come see me at the church? You've been promising me that." And he hung his head. He said, "Yeah, I have." He said, "But I just kind of do the Jesus thing." I said, "Well, you would really fit in our church."
Yes.
Because that's what we do.
Yep.
And I said, "We just come together and have church." And one thing opened to another, and we started talking. And I don't know that he's going to come, but there is a hunger developing out here for the real thing.
Yes.
There's a hunger out there.
Yes, amen.
And I was listening, I don't recall where I heard this, but it seems I don't recall, but that the population of 20-some% are churchgoers, regular churchgoers. That's terrible. Our country was not like that.
No, it wasn't.
And but there are the people going to church consistently, but there is also another side to that. That what has the church done to help them to find Jesus Christ?
Amen.
And to point them to the Lord.
Right.
When they make it, they doctor it up and they make it sound. They deal with the flesh, and that's all they talk to. They talk to the flesh. They don't really help them find Christ. But do you know there are people out there that are hungry?
Yes.
They're hungry.
Yes, amen.
And I got a phone call this week of a man all the way from Indiana, and he met me one time. And he called me this week. And he said, "Brother Zonneville, I don't know if you remember me or not, but I was sitting in a church service with you, and you and your wife were sitting right behind me, or I was sitting behind you. You were in this congregational area." And he said, "I felt something from you guys that I don't feel where I'm at."
Yes.
"And I feel a blessing. I feel a sweet, tender spirit, the right spirit." And he said, "First of the year, I'm going to make tracks to come to Sebring and to be in the Sebring church services, because I feel like I need to be there, need to be where God's people are open." I said, "The door's open for you to come, brother, and just come and be a part." Well, I hear more of that than I've ever heard.
Yes, amen.
And out of that, you know, I don't know how many hundreds of people that you have to talk to when one.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't think it's just 5 or 6.
No.
I think it's hundreds sometimes.
Yeah.
People that we have to get in contact with.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some of us have tried to work on the immediate surroundings, possibly family, friends, associates, and we just, you know, we keep trying. Well, sometimes it might be better to focus on someone else, or to focus in another direction. And to find a door, you know, sometimes maybe going to the next door neighbor, you know, knocking on their door. "Well, that's hard for me to do." Well, it is. It's hard for me to do. It's hard for anyone to do. But do you know what? I used to sell, and I was a salesman. I sold life insurance for 3 or 4 years before I went to the air conditioning business. I went back in the air conditioning business. And the hardest thing, as outgoing as I am, yet it was hard for me to go door to door, to knock on doors.
Mm-hmm.
But that was part of the sales. That was part of the sales. I'd rather network. You know what I mean by networking? That when you come in contact with a group, with a person, then you find out family. Just in conversation, you find these things out. You make a record of it in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And that family and that person that you might go to from this person to that person, because you might not reach this one, but then you go to that one.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, there are 3 or 4 others.
Right. Yeah.
When I first went to sales, it was hard. I'm telling you, it was hard to go knock on doors. But I found out that if I talked to the customers that I had,
yeah,
there's always someone else that needs the service that I have. But sometimes it just takes. And I'm going to set up a Saturday where we just go knocking on doors and reaching for people, because I want to see people. Now, I don't want, it's not that I want to see numbers in this church, but I want to see people get what I've got.
Amen.
I want people to receive what we have. And to tell them how, you know, and if I'm not enthused about what I have, then I'm not going to share that with anyone else.
Amen.
If I'm just coming to be in a form and a fashion, and, you know, I come to church to be in a part of a form, or not, and I isolate myself just for the immediate surroundings, but that's not what it is.
Mm-hmm.
What we have, my God, it's a treasure.
Yes, it is.
It's a treasure.
Mm-hmm.
And I want people to receive it.
Yes.
Maybe my immediate family won't receive it. I'm sad. Yes, I am. I'm sad about
that.
Yes. But there's someone else. I'm not going to just stop because my family don't want to hear what I've got to say.
Amen.
And it's not so much that they have to listen to what I've got to say, but I want to share with them about the goodness of God.
Yes.
And the work of the Lord. And the revelation that God has given me. Praise God.
Amen.
Listening to Sister Wilma this weekend, and I see her. Boy, I tell you, God's helping her.
Amen.
Starting to see things. And you know what I like about her is she's not so proud that she can say, that she would keep that and contain that. And wouldn't want people to feel like that. She was just a new, getting this fresh, you know, in other words, hide behind her years of being in the body.
Yes.
You know, but I'm so proud of her that she gets up. My God. How about the revelation of the light that she got this weekend?
Amen.
And let her see that, what is the light? The light is eternal life. And the more you get of Jesus, the more eternal life you're going to have.
Right.
And it grows. Well, we've got a real opportunity this year. God is going to help our assembly more than he has. And he thanked the Lord for this past year.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Yes. Let's get a song. Let's just get a song and I want you to mix your voice. All right?
Man.
Share something. I mean, even if you don't normally get up, it'd be nice to hear you say how good it is to be a part of the family of God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.